So I'm going to conduct this a little bit differently. First, I'm going to, we're going to conduct this a little more like a lecture and a bit more like a verse-by-verse study. First, I'm going to just read the passage. I'm not going to tell you where because I want you to guess when I'm done. Some of you know, but if you know, don't give it away. So I'm just going to load the passage into our brains, and then I'll break it down. So without any further ado, here we go. Ready? If you're wondering, using the ESV translation. Behold, my servant shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up, and shall be exalted. As many were astonished by you, his appearance was so marred beyond human semblance, his form beyond that of the children of mankind. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him. For that which has not been told them they see, and that which they have not heard they understand. Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? That's the footnote. For he grew up before him like a young plant, like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his stripes we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid upon, or on him, the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, and he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and of his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people? And they made his grave with the wicked, and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for peace, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide him a portion with the strong, with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and makes intercession for the transgressors. Now, I want to ask two questions. First, who is this about? And secondly, where is this passage found?
That was a lot.
If anyone were to guess.
I think it's definitely talking about, like, Jesus Christ.
Okay. Yes. Well, where is it from?
You told me this before.
Well, I
want
to hear from people who might not know. Okay, let me break it down. So, believe it or not, this passage actually comes from the Old Testament. It comes from Isaiah chapter 52, verse 13, through chapter 53, verse 12. King James people put the chapter break in the right spot, but that's okay. Now, what I want to do is go back and, with whatever much time we can, break this down somewhat so we can understand it a little better. I like the apologetics and the getting the nitty gritty. I understand a lot of these studies tend to go for life application, but I think it's just cool to know some of the gems that are just embedded within Scripture themselves. And this is what I like to call the gospel according to Isaiah. So starting back at 52:13, behold, my servant shall act wisely. The King James, New King James, it says, he shall deal prudently, which is like to understand or to know how and when to say or apply a certain thing in different situations. So he would be shrewd, kind of what that means. He shall be high and lifted up and shall be exalted. This has a double meaning. High, lifted up, exalted, these are all like a glorification language for having to do with Jesus being glorified for the Messiah, the servant of the Lord. But lifted up is also, if you look in the Gospel of John, it's also kind of how he refers to the combined event of the crucifixion and the resurrection. Lifted up as in like lifted up on a tree, but also lifted up to heaven. So I think that's interesting. As many were astonished at you, he's referring to the nation of Israel. And it says that his appearance was so marred beyond human semblance and his form beyond that the children of mankind. This means that I tend to think this refers to the crucifixion, because when you look at someone who's crucified, they would whip them with a whip with like six thongs with, it's called a flagrum or a cat of nine tails, with pieces of bone and metal embedded into the leather thongs to rip out chunks of flesh. It's called the pre-death, and some people actually died before they even nailed up on the cross. But it got to the point where you would look at a crucifixion victim and you'd go, what is that? Because you wouldn't recognize it as a human being. It's just so deformed and mangled from the process. And that's how the Lord describes his servant. So it shall be sprinkled many nations. So I really like this part because it refers to, if you read in Leviticus, it's called throughout this. It talks about sprinkling the altar or like the ark, I don't remember exactly what, but I think it was like, it was the horns of the altar. You'd sprinkle blood on everything in certain sacrifices, because blood was seen as the atonement. Like, something had to die, like an animal had to die to make up for some sort of sin, or to make peace with God. And it's saying, he shall sprinkle many nations, and there's a footnote that says, like, astonish many nations. But, and then it says, kings shall shut their mouths because of him, which that basically means they'll be like stunned into silence. And we see that even in the Gospels with the prefect Pontius Pilate, because Jesus didn't give a defense for himself. And when he was brought before Herod and Luke, he didn't say anything either, so they're just astonished. They didn't really know what to say. And then it says, for that which has not been told, they told them they see, and that which they have not heard, they understand. Basically, kings are going to hear about what happened to this guy, the servant of the Lord, and they're going to be stunned because they've never heard something like this before. And I ask you, which message in the world has traveled further in the world?
Jesus.
More geographically dispersed than the gospel of Jesus Christ. I can hardly think of anything else. And then it goes on to 53. I'm trying to move a little bit faster through this. I might go through this in sets here, sets of three. Who has believed what he has heard from us, or the King James, and King James says, who has believed our report? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? So that's 53:1. I believe this refers to, I found an interesting interpretation of that first line in that, like, who has believed what he's heard from us? Me basically refers to how we're saved through believing, through faith, a report, a testimony. And then starts talking about him. For he grew up before him like a young plant, so he was weak, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. So he wasn't particularly attractive. He was maybe an average-looking guy. he was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hid their faces. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. So this guy's going to come. He's the servant of Yahweh himself, and yet no one recognizes him for it. He's completely just despised by his own people, by the Jewish people. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. So they think, oh, he's, and this was often the case with, like, capital punishment victims. They figure, well, God must not be on their side if he's being nailed up on a tree, because there's a portion in the law that says, you know, I think it's in Deuteronomy and Leviticus somewhere, where it says, if you hang a body on a tree, or kill someone by hanging them on a tree, they don't let them stay up there until the next day, because cursed is he who hangs on a tree. So they would have seen him as cursed by God, because he died while hanging on wood, or the cross. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his stripes we are healed. This is substitutionary atonement language. This is someone or something, in this case the Messiah, the Christ, coming into our place and taking the punishment that we deserve so that we may live. That's what this refers to here. And it's elaborated on the next verse. We all like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. So he got a punishment that we deserve. That's basically what this is saying here. Okay, you got something. How much time do I have?
About 5 minutes.
Okay, I'll see if I can get through this. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. So I want to address this really quick. A lot of people think that this means that before the Sanhedrin and before Pilate, Jesus was just like completely mute. He was just like, but he wasn't necessarily. Because we see in John that he does talk. He just doesn't give an answer in defense for himself. So this is a little bit more of a legal term. And so is this next point I'm going to highlight. By oppression and judgment, he was taken away. So this is a judicial thing. As for his generation, who considered that he was, okay, here's what I want to highlight. He was cut off out of the land of the living. And this refers to a death penalty sentence under the Mosaic, under the law of Moses. It, like, if like someone does this, you're to cut him off. It's kind of a saying, he gets the electric chair. That was kind of like the term they used. He should be cut. He was cut off out of the land of the living. And then it goes on, stricken for the transgression of my people. And that just kind of plays back into what you're talking about before, with him taking our place. And they made his grave with the wicked, with the wicked, and with a rich man in his death. Now, this refers to Jesus being buried in the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea, because he was a rich man and he was buried in his tomb. But he was crucified between two criminals. And so he died among the wicked, and he was buried in a rich man's tomb. So this is very, very specific. Although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. But this just reminds me of the thief in Luke chapter 23 that basically came to Christ and he realized that, hey, he deserved to be here. I deserve to be here, but this guy hasn't done anything wrong. Now this is the turnaround here. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. Or the semantic range here would also apply, it pleased the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. So he put the Messiah to grief here. He's put him through a lot. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, again, sacrificial language here, he shall see his offspring, he shall prolong his days. He shall prolong his days. So we've already established this guy's dead. He's cut off out of the land of the living. But then it says his days are going to be prolonged. If he's dead, what does that mean? It means he's alive again. This is referring to the resurrection in the Old Testament. For the Gospels were written, for the letters of Paul, the Gospels were written. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anger. anguish of his soul he shall see and be satisfied. So he's going to see, like, this is miserable, but it's worth it in the end. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous. And we see this in the letters of Paul, that we can't be righteous enough on our own to seek God or to find God. We have to come humbly and accept Jesus' righteousness through repenting of our sins. And he shall bear their iniquities. I probably should have just finished that. Okay, last verse, I promise.
Awesome.
Therefore, I will divide him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong. So, a lot of times in prophecy, when talking about the Messiah, the prophets will kind of write about Jesus' first coming and his second coming, kind of written together. The Jews, and it was kind of meant to maybe be a little bit vague. This is why the disciples, like Peter, James, John, they thought Jesus was going to come and overthrow Rome and establish the kingdom of Israel, because they didn't realize he was coming twice. Because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Numbered with the transgressors, this part is quoted by the Gospel of John, so the New Testament authors picked up on this. He also quoted 53 verse 1, he was believed what he served from us. Yet he bore the sin of many and makes intercession for the transgressors. This refers to 1 Timothy, and then this is referenced, I believe, in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15, which says there is one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. So through what he did, he acts as both the sacrifice and the high priest who operates in the heavenly tabernacle on our behalf. So that's my little Bible study of the messianic part of Isaiah. Or there are many different, like, they're called like servant songs in Isaiah. This is just one of them, but it's got to be my favorite because it's like this and Psalm 22 are like some of the clearest prophetic passages in the Old Testament about Jesus. And it just helps to know how Jewish the Christian faith is, because sometimes we tend to lose track of kind of where our faith grew from. So, thanks for sticking with me. Shout out to my sister, Zero Killz, for manning the camera. And if you don't mind, do you mind if I pray? Shout out to next guy.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Father, I thank you for this time that we can come together to learn from your word. I know this was a slightly different style, but I pray that it would still glorify you, and that this would stay in people's heads throughout the day and throughout the coming week and months and years. That it would get them to really think about understanding what your word truly says and how we can apply those truths to our lives and to our efforts to fulfill your great commission to go and make disciples of all nations. And I pray that you would bless this day and that you'd be able to glorify you for it. In Jesus' name, I pray.
Amen.
One big clap for David. Woo! Hey, yeah, Book of Hebrews is good stuff. Talks about the... it talks about the atonement and the idea that there is nothing... There's nothing that you can do to make yourself right with God. Only Christ can do that for you.
Yeah. Hebrews is one of the most Old Testament focused books in the New Testament, along with the Book of Matthew, I would argue.
So actually, much of what happens, there are passages that come out of Isaiah that are quoted in Hebrews.
Yeah.
From that part. So, in any event, have a great week. I'll see you back here next Thursday. And we'll put it, do a better job of getting it on the
Time.
And bring friends.
Yep.
All right, get out of here. See you.